I love that song. There's a whole lot of meaning to that song. And that's beautiful. I just really enjoy the songs that you folks sing at the church. It's wonderful, wonderful to hear. I didn't get to hear it all. I was back there trying to finish getting ready. But from what I heard, you did good. Didn't you? Did Mama tell you did good? She did. Amen. It's good seeing you this morning. I hope all is well with you on this Memorial Day weekend. I hope that you've got some plans to spend time with loved ones. Maybe you get the day off tomorrow. If that be the case, then we ain't in no hurry today. We'll just stay here all day. Oh, you want to eat? Well, I try to tell people all the time, you know, the longer I preach, the more the crowd gets out of that restaurant y'all are going to go to. So, in a way, long-winded preaching is doing y'all a favor. Y'all see it that way? Tweet, thank you for lying. That's what, amen. Yeah, you're used to it. Amen. Amen. But, you know, I've had on my mind the events of the weekend. Of course, you can't help but hear people talk about it and everything. And one word that just kind of kept coming to mind, and for the Christian, when you think about things like what we have this weekend, and when you start to think about it, there's one word that just kind of comes to mind, and it's sacrifice. Of course, we talked a moment ago, and we honored those who have sacrificed their lives on foreign and domestic soils for our freedom. But there's also a sacrifice in view of that, and not take away from that, but there's a sacrifice that stands even above that sacrifice, and it's a sacrifice that took place on Calvary a long time ago. That will forever stand as the greatest act of love for a people who didn't deserve it that we'll ever know. And if you got your Bibles, I want you to go with me to Romans. Romans chapter 12 this morning. Romans chapter 12. I want to look at the first two verses. Maybe this is familiar text for you. Romans chapter 12, the first two verses. I want to preach to you this morning on a sacred sacrifice. A sacred sacrifice. Romans chapter 12, Paul is writing to the church, and he talks of this very subject of sacrifice. And it's something that should be a Christian principle, a Christian value. But you'll learn as you grow in your walk with Christ that this thought of sacrifice is a foreign one to this world we live in. They don't see it the same way that God sees it. And they sure don't practice it the same way that God teaches it. But I think we would be much better for it if we see it as God intends it to be. So Romans chapter 12, the first two verses, if you've got it, say amen. The Bible says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Father, we thank you for letting us come together. We thank you for everything that we've done this morning so far. It's been a blessing from the time we walked into Sunday school to now. My heart's filled with joy, and I thank you for that. And I pray, God, now as we stand before your word, God, that I will stand behind you, behind the cross, behind everything you are, that I may not be heard or seen, but that you might be seen, you might be heard, that you would be lifted up and glorified. Father, use the scripture to benefit your cause of the saving of the lost soul and drawing the Christians closer to you. And Father, if there is one in here that's lost that is not yet yours, I pray that you'll show them their condition, that they'll come to Christ before we leave here today. Father, we love you and we thank you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The concept of sacrifice is kind of lost on this world. We kind of have adopted a mentality that says every man for himself, or I'm looking out for number one. Y'all ever heard those sayings? And those are popular, and those are out there. And in some instances, people are taught those things as a way of truth, as something, a motto for them to adopt for their life. Make sure you take care of yourself, then you take care of everything else. Make sure you put yourself above all. And while I think there may be some threads of truth woven in, I think the overall design of that pattern is not biblical. And the concept of sacrifice according to the Bible is something that is foreign to most people. And I think we have to look at it and see it for what it is, because if we let the world teach us, it's not going to be that at all. There's a little story I heard, and you maybe have heard this, but I heard about a little girl who had a illness of some kind. I don't remember what it was, but she needed blood. And they were trying to find a match. She had a unique type of blood. Anyway, it goes on. They find out that the family's talking about it, and the brother has the same blood type as the sister. So they asked this little boy, said, "Would you be willing to give some blood to your sister?" And the little boy paused for a minute, and he said, "Okay." So they took him in. They started preparing him, and they noticed this little boy was just really nervous, you know, kind of anxious. He wasn't saying much, but he was just, you know, you could tell something was bothering him. And as they, you know, they got everything ready, they got him in the chair, you know, they put the little wraps. If you ever give blood, when they start tying that thing around you, that's when panic sets in. When they put that little, what is that thing, a rubber band or something they tie around you? That's bad. Yeah, that. I thought that was when you lost a limb, you know. But anyway, they got this little boy sitting in the chair. They're getting him ready, and the little phlebotomist there, she notices tears starting to stream from the boy's eyes. And she says, "Son, what's the matter?" He just said, he kind of asked her, "Is it going to hurt?" And she said, "No." I said, "You know, just for a quick second, then, you know, it won't hurt no more." And he said, "How long will it take?" And she said, "Well, just, you know, a few minutes." And another tear rolled down his eye. And he said, "Tell my sister I love her." And this nurse was like, "Wait a minute. Son, what do you think is fixing to happen? I'm giving her my blood so she'll live." And the nurse said, "Oh, no, that's not what we're doing. You're just giving her a little bit of your blood so that she would live." This little boy thought he was giving it all. He thought he was laying down to die that his sister might live. That's sacrifice. That's looking at another and saying, "You know what? I love that one, and I'll do what I can." That's a beautiful story. But the concept is the same. And as we look at the Bible, we see that idea, that concept of sacrifice is something that God wants us to have, because it's the concept of sacrifice that God had when it came to us. Now, if you look at Romans chapter 12, it's a beautiful, beautiful chapter. I wish we had time to deal with all of it, but some people get hungry. And, you know, all the good food at the buffet is gone after 1:30. So we have to kind of have to hurry along here. But, no, I'm kidding about that. But in Romans 12, 1 and 2, Paul deals with this very thing of sacrifice. Now, he's teaching a new concept to them. The Romans had the same ideology that America and the rest of the world has today. It was number one, looking out for number one, what I want, what I need, and then if I might help you if I've got some time, or I might do something for you if I can, but I've got to look out for me first. And Paul begins to teach them what sacrifice really is. What does it take for a person to be willing to sacrifice for others? That's the question to us today. What does it take for a person to be willing to sacrifice for others? What's it going to take for you to be a, if you will, sacrificial Christian? Now, we're not talking about laying your life down. We're not talking about you dying as Christ died for us. Paul said there in the first verse, a living sacrifice. While you're living, you're yet a sacrifice. How can we do that? Well, let's take a look. I think we see it told to us here. I'll give you three thoughts this morning, then we'll be done. First thing, if you'll look at verse 2, actually, we're going to start with verse 2 today. First thing I want you to see, we must be willing to learn something about God. If we are going to sacrifice as God wants us to sacrifice and be a sacrificial Christian, by the way, God wants you to be a sacrificial Christian. God wants you to sacrifice and be a living sacrifice. Now, how do we do that? First of all, verse 2, we must be willing to learn something about God. Why? Because what we know isn't right. Verse 2 says, and be not conformed to this world. What does that mean? Don't act like the world. Don't think like the world. Don't sacrifice like the world. You see, the way the world would sacrifice is, if I've got anything left, you're welcome to it. If I've got any left over after I'm done satisfying my needs, my urges, my wants, then I'll help you. It's kind of the mentality where the homeless man in the street we won't give him the food off the table, but we don't mind him digging through the dumpster. It's kind of that whole thing. It's not really a sacrifice. It's pity, really, it kind of turns into. Be not conformed to the world. If you're going to sacrifice and be a sacrificial Christian and have a sacrificing heart, which, by the way, is what God wants, we're going to have to learn something about God. And the only way we're going to learn something about God is to get into his word. Get out of the world and into the word. Because if we're in the world, it's going to teach us how they want us to do things. How to put yourself first. But God teaches us something different. Be not conformed to this world, but he says, verse 2, be transformed, be changed by the renewing of your mind. Change the way you think. Change the way you approach things. How are you living your life? Are you living your life to satisfy your needs? Or do the needs of others, does it ever come up? Now, don't take me wrong. I'm not saying go sell everything you have and just start giving it away and live as a pauper. I'm not saying that. But what I am saying is when it comes to others, does their need register at all? Does their situation mean anything? Jesus would go without sleep to heal the sick and afflicted. Jesus would go without a home so he could travel to those who needed him. Jesus lived his life, but he still took time to care about those who needed to be loved. Do you know anybody in this world that needs to be loved? I know Brandy says it's her, but I need to love her. But we all know somebody in this world who needs to know what the love of God feels like. Sometimes you need it, don't you? Sometimes we need to know that God loves us. There's people out there that need that. And we have got to be willing to put them up so that we can help them. And God, I think, is trying to teach us that. That you may prove what is that good, verse 2, and acceptable and perfect will of God. God wants us to have a sacrificing heart. God wants us to put others up. And not necessarily put us down, but bring us up. Now look in verse 1. Let's go to verse 1. We must be willing to learn something about God. We've got to learn how to love. Look at verse 1. It says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice. Not only one must be we willing to learn something about God, we must be willing to love something like God loves it. How much does God love you? You really have to answer that. It does me no good to tell you that. I could stand up here and preach and proclaim and scream all day long about how much God loves you, but how much do you think God loves you? Some people think God loves them a little. Some people think God loves them sometimes. Some people think God loves them when I'm doing good. But it's hard to find people anymore who think God loves them all the time. But God does. He doesn't love you because you can be good. He loves you because Jesus died for you. And a few chapters over in the book of Romans, there's no more condemnation for those who are in Christ. He loves you. And we've got to love to learn others. We've got to learn to love other things like God loves, unconditionally. And he says to present our bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. What does that mean? That means we have got to start loving other people with the same kind of love that God has, the kind of love that God has for you. Do you think God's forgiven you? Don't we relish in that fact that God's mercy is new every day? Don't we rejoice in the fact that every day God's love for me is stronger, it's never changing, despite how bad I've been, God loves me. Don't we rejoice in that? We sing songs about it, and when we preach about it, we get those good feelings on the inside because we're reminded that God's love for us is not conditional. A sacrificial love of a Christian should be that we love each other like that. When we're doing good, it's easy to love. But when somebody's struggling, or sometimes people just hard to love like Chase. Not you, my Chase. But I love you, son. You're the first person I seen. I almost got Jimmy, but that'd been bad, so I went with you. But there are people in this world who are just hard to get along with. They're difficult people. Our personalities don't mix. They're just different. They got different beliefs or views than us. And most of the time, we tend to avoid those people. What if God avoided you and I? Because there's things I do that's contrary to the word of God, to the will of God. There's things I do that God's just not happy with. And until I get that straightened out with God, what if he just ignored me? He loves me. we're to love others, not because they're lovable, but because God loves them. Sacrificial love means loving them in spite of what they've done, in spite of who they are, in spite of, you know, the fact that they may not love you back. Caring about them, praying for them, loving them, telling them that God loves them, telling them Jesus died for them, and telling them there's a better way and there's hope. Sacrifice, telling somebody that God loves them. Be willing to do that. Paul tells the Romans, look, quit worrying about yourselves and start putting others up and willing to be a living sacrifice. Not only that, we must be willing, thirdly, if we go back to verse 1, to lose something for God. We must be willing to learn something about God. We must be willing to love something like God loves it. We must be willing, thirdly, to lose something for God. Verse 1 says, a living sacrifice. The word sacrifice has the whole idea of giving something up, of doing without something, of willingly handing something over. In the Old Testament, those little sheeps and rams and turtle doves, they were sacrifices. They gave their life for the cause of the sacrifice of worship of God. We're not called to do that, but we're called to be a living sacrifice. What does that mean? That means God wants us to live, but He wants us to totally give ourselves to Him. Totally give ourselves over to Him. Why? Paul said, it's a service. It's what we do. As a Christian, we no longer serve ourselves. We're sacrificing that, okay? We're sacrificing our wants, if you will, to say, God, I want to serve you. And God, I want to serve you with my life. And here's the direction that my life seems to be going. And Lord, if this is where I'm going with you, then let's go. But let me serve you through that way. There's nothing wrong with having plans. There's nothing wrong with going to school or planning for the future, having careers. There's nothing wrong with those things. But make sure that you tell God, Lord, I want to serve you, and no matter what I'm doing, where I am. And Lord, lead me to something where I can serve you. Living sacrifice that says, I want to put others up, Lord, like you put Jesus for me. Put God, remember, God has always got to be first. But let's love everybody else too. Let's not leave those in the dust. Let's not leave people out who feel like nobody loves them. Some people to this day still have a view of the church that the church, you know, as long as you're going there and you're part of that church, they love you. But if you're an outsider, you know, you're kind of out. And that's terrible. It should not be that way. The church should be exactly what we say it is. You know, everybody welcome. Come on in. The person that walks in through those doors that we've never met, that we've never talked to, the person that comes in who's the town drunk or the town drug dealer who's been in prison, when they come in and they say, I'm coming back. I want to serve God. We should rejoice in that. Say, praise God, brother. Praise God, sister. We're glad to hear that. We want to help you. That is sacrificing. Now, the world may say, oh, they let somebody like that in their church? You remember when Jesus had Zacchaeus over? That bunch didn't like that, did they? Man, look here, he's fraternizing with sinners. What's he doing? He's ruining his reputation. Jesus said, no, I'm doing the work of God. Loving other people, sacrificial love. Sister, I'm going to die if I don't say it, but did I hear that you're an officer, police officer? Did I hear that correctly? Well, you are a living embodiment of that. In your job, you're putting the needs of others sometimes above your own. Soldiers, we've got soldiers in here. We've got people who do public service of different kinds. Joyce, I know you were an EMT at one point or that too. You do that too? Overachiever much? I'm kidding. Hey, you got to keep coming back because one day I'm going to fall out on this place and I'm going to need somebody to help me out, okay? Amen. But that's the embodiment of that. Living your life and saying, God, use me. Use me to help somebody. Use me to love somebody. Look, folks, let me share a little secret with you. Jesus went to heaven. Y'all realize that? He ascended. He up there. But there's one thing's been left here. You remember what that was? The Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost has been left here. Where is it? It's in you. He's not driving around in a taxi. He's not in a building waiting on somebody to come say hi. He lives in you. You are the vessel of Christ. You are the gospel. You are the carrier of the good news of the gospel of Christ. And we need to start to live like that and say, God, let me serve you today. God, let me do something for you. Let me let somebody else know how much you love them today. Let me share with someone else, God, what you've shared with me. Have you ever had a chance to do that? Maybe a stranger, or maybe somebody you know that's going through a hard time, and you can say, you know what? I went through something like that once. Here a while back, I saw or went through that same thing, and God helped me. Here's how God helped me. Can I tell you? That is loving somebody. That's loving sacrificially. Paul said, present your bodies to God, a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your service. Right? Reasonable. Don't leave that word out. Reasonable service. You know what that means? It means it's not asking too much. Sometimes we think this whole thing of telling others God loves them and sharing the gospel with them and living for Jesus in a world. We talked about that in Sunday school, Tommy, about taking a stand, you know, standing up, speaking up. People think, oh, that's too much, too hard. Paul said, that's reasonable. Paul said, what I'm doing is a lot. I'm going all over the world, preaching the gospel, getting stoned, shipwrecked, snake bit, falsely accused, trying to kill me. I'm not asking you to do what I'm doing. All I ask you to do is present your bodies to God and say, Lord, here I am. What do you need? Can I challenge you to pray that way tomorrow morning when you wake up? Or tonight, some of you work third shift, I know. But before you start out on your day, whether it's tonight, tomorrow, or Tuesday with the holiday, before you leave your house, ask God to make you, or tell God this, say, Lord, here I am. I want to be a living sacrifice to you. Use me today. Use me today, however you would need to use me. God might send some hurting soul across your path. God might put some hurting soul on your mind. You never know what God will do. Let God use you. And then go out there and love. You know why? Because God so loved the world that he gave. He gave his only begotten Son. And whosoever would believe in him, not going to perish, but have everlasting life. Present yourselves a sacrifice and do it because Jesus did it for you. That's what Jesus did. It's not said in so many words, but Jesus stood up one day in this meeting between Father, Son, and Holy Ghost in heaven before the earth was ever created and the plans for the universe were being laid out. It came up and it was addressed. There's sin coming. This man we're getting ready to create, this world we're getting ready to form, it can't hold itself. It can't do it. What are we going to do? And Jesus says, I'll die for them. Our price is blood, is it not? I'll let them go for a few thousand years, do their thing. But from the very beginning, we're going to set the stage for me to come. And when I come to the world, I'll make the sacrifice for them. And that's exactly what he did. He was born to die. He came, spent three and a half years or so on this earth. He took a cross that wasn't his. It belonged to you and I, didn't he? He laid down and he died. And you know why he did that? Because he loves you. Because he looked down through time, he saw your face. And he said, you know what? I love them. And I don't want to see them die in their sin. I don't want to see them unable to be in the presence of God because of their sin. I want to make a way for them to have forgiveness. And not just forgiveness, but permanent forgiveness. He said, I'll do it. I'll take the cross. In Revelations, it says they was trying to open that book. They couldn't find nobody who could open it. But the Lion of the tribe of Judah stepped forth. And he roared with a sound that shook the universe and said, I paid the price. I can open it. That's my Jesus. Listen to me. If you're here today and you're saved, I want you to know something. Jesus sacrificed it all for you. You be a living sacrifice for him. Say, Lord Jesus, I don't know what I can do for you. Now, don't be afraid. He's not going to have you out there preaching if he don't want you to preach. He's not going to have you singing if you don't want to sing, I don't think. But I'll tell you, if you'll just tell God, look, you know me, God. You made me. You made my voice. You made my hair, my eyes, my height, my weight. You made my family, my friends. You made everything about me, Lord. Here I am. What can I do? And that's what God wants. A living sacrifice. Will you do that? Will you do that for him? Now, if you're not saved, I need to talk to you for just a minute. The greatest gift there's ever been given, the greatest sacrifice man will ever know, was not on a battlefield on this earth. It was on a hill in Jerusalem where Jesus hung between heaven and hell, innocent. And he was beaten beyond recognition. He was tortured beyond what any human could ever endure. Matter of fact, he even told us, he said, Pilate, you can't kill me. They tried. I make them soldiers might have heard him say that. I don't know. They said, well, we'll see about that. Most crucifixion victims died before they ever got to the cross. Josephus said he was holding in his inward parts. He was beaten and tortured and cut so badly. He kept himself alive until he was then nailed to a cross like that one, but much larger. He didn't fight. He was led to the slaughter as a lamb before its shears is dumb. He spoke not nothing. He laid there. And when he finally spoke, you know what he said? Father, forgive them. In the midst of an agony and torture and pain beyond comprehension, he said, Father, forgive them. Was he just talking to the Romans? No. In theory, yes. In technicality, that was spoken that they may hear it there. But that word reverberated throughout the ages. Father, forgive them. What Jesus is saying, God, look. I did it. I'm doing it. I'm paying the price for them, for you. And it got to the place to where God had to turn his back. Bible says the earth went dark because there was separation. God himself was divided. That's hard to understand, but it is so amazing that God was able to separate himself from Jesus, who are one. Jesus never felt that before. He said, Father, where are you? Why have you forsaken me? But at the end of it all, the last thing he said, it's finished. What? The payment. You ever paid off a bill? You send that last payment in, feels good, don't it? No more payments. It's done. Jesus laid on that cross, paying for our sins, all of them. And when the last one was paid for, he said, it's finished. And then he went home. Now today, that blood that was shed is just as real and just as good today as it's ever been. If you have not come to salvation, if you've not ever accepted that death of Christ for your sins, you can do that today. You can do it today. You can say, Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner. I know it. I admit it. But I believe. I believe that was for me. Jesus saved me. And my friend, he'll hear and he'll answer so quick you won't know what's happened. Any that come unto him, he will no wise cast out. Christians, amen? He didn't tell you no, did he? He won't tell you no either. Would you come to Jesus and know the greatest love this world has ever known? Christian, let's walk out of here knowing we're loved with the greatest love we've ever known. And let's present our bodies a living sacrifice. Let's stand together all around the church this morning.